Thank you, Savard. Thank you, Svetlana. What I'd like to do is actually focus this talk only on cryo-EM. The abstract was written to be a bit more general, but having seen the title of the session, I decided I would make it a little more focused on cryo-EM of protein assemblies. And if you could, you can't see what I'm showing here, can you? Should work out. The only thing is we might dim the lights a little bit, if I can. Is that good? Can you see? Okay, great. Okay, so some of you may have seen that Nature Methods chose to highlight cryo-EM as the method of the year this year in January's issue. And what's interesting to me is it features a polar ice cap, presumably with ice on it, with beta galactosidase floating on top. But if you read the legend, it tells you that this is Nature's method of the year for the year 2015. So this is already last year's method. So we have to wait and see what happens in 2016. So it's as Richard has been mentioning, it certainly has caught many people's imagination. And on the face of it, it does look relatively easy. Essentially, all you have to do is you start with a drop of liquid. You deliver it to an EM grid, 3 millimeters wide. You blot it with water number one, 19th century technology filter paper. And at which point, you have a thin film of molecules which are still in their physiological buffer, at which point it's frozen in liquid ethane that's cooled by liquid nitrogen. And after this point, everything is frozen, preserved, and it can be then delivered into, in this instance, a cassette of an FEI Titan Krios microscope. It's transferred to a capsule, and then it just gets loaded manually into a microscope like the one that's shown here. At this point, many of the steps are largely automated, and pictures like this begin to emerge. And you can cut them all up, line them up, and before long, one can emerge with a 3D structure. So this is a 3D structure of beta galactosidase. In 2014, we had this at about 3.2 angstrom resolution. So that's the workflow that most people execute is pretty much what's shown here. What I'd like to tell you about today is to give you a bit of an update on the beta galactosidase work that we published last year, continuing this theme that Richard and I started many years ago on using this as a test case. And then I'd like to go on to four specific examples where we're using cryo-EM to actually describe specific and new mechanistic insights that come from the cryo-EM work in ways that both extend and also combine the work, the things that we've known from crystallography before on these proteins. So I'd like to begin with the work on beta galactosidase. And after the work 2 years ago where we reported the 3.2 angstrom resolution, we were very much taken by figuring out what it takes to go beyond 3 angstroms. Because many in the field at the end of 2014 felt that structures were really stuck at about 3 angstroms, and not knowing better, we kept pushing and looked essentially focused on improving data quality, which was clearly something that could use improvement. And as we progressively began to get images, which you can see on the left-hand side is a typical cryo-EM image, and the right-hand side is a Fourier transform. When we began to reliably see information going beyond 2.5 angstroms, we felt that this would work out, and this led last year to the work we published on the structure of beta galactosidase, where many of the central regions of the protein were at resolutions of 2.2 angstroms. To give you a feeling for what the map looks like at these resolutions, here are some examples of representative residues, arginines, lysines, you can see all the way out to the end, glutamines, so you can see the larger sulfur atom, you can see holes in aromatic residues, you can see aspartic acid residues, and also particularly for us water molecules, which we were very much taken by, the ability to visualize water molecules. And that had a particular significance because the focus of our work then and particularly now was to begin to visualize the locations and the interactions of small molecule inhibitors in the active sites and other regions of proteins. And in this case, we crystallized that with this work in beta galactosidase was a complex with PETG, a ligand, for which there was no crystal structure. But what's interesting here is that we show the identification of a single water molecule between the ligand and the protein. And this is the kind of thing that people doing drug discovery like a lot, because then you know exactly what kinds of things to change on the ligand to make it more potent. The work on beta galactoside is really sharpened for us. Many of the methods that we use improve the workflow, and the four examples I want to share with you are at varying resolutions, but as I said before, have been teaching us about mechanistic aspects that really come uniquely from the use of cryo-EM. The first of these was work that we began a couple of years ago on the studies of glutamate receptor, a medically, clinically important molecule. There's many, many variants of this molecule involved in normal function of the brain. It's involved in Alzheimer's and memory loss, et cetera. And in 2014, we had essentially tamed the system to get about 7 axon structures of AMPA and the kinate receptors where we could begin to see the global structural changes. And the main discovery at that point was the identification of 2 major changes as these receptors went through their gating cycle. The first of these was the opening that you see on the left-hand side. When the channel opens upon glutamate binding, ions flow through the membrane. The surprise was when we captured the desensitized state, which you see as the third piece in this triangle, we showed that the desensitized state had apparent fourfold symmetry in the ligand binding domain, which is a very surprising result at the time, because there was these receptors essentially show twofold symmetry, even though they have four identical chains. The reason it was interesting also was because we showed that in the course of this desensitization, there were dramatic conformational changes. And this was unanticipated in part because the desensitized receptor also has a closed channel, the resting state receptor has a closed channel, and the presumption was that these would be very similar. But our work led to the discovery that there were really dramatic and large changes. And one of the reasons, interestingly, in hindsight, why people found it surprising was cross-linking studies had shown that the same residues were cross-linked in both the resting state and the desensitized state. So the result was correct, no doubt, but the conclusion that it implied no conformational changes was wrong, because it turns out that the changes are so large that the cross-link is to the same residue on the next subunit. So that was an interesting example of using cryo-EM to look at these changes. In the last year, we have now pushed this. This is arguably one of the most challenging things we worked on in the lab, now to about 3.8 axon resolution, where we have the structure of the desensitized state. It's the first structure of the desensitized state of any glutamate receptor, to my knowledge, where we can now visualize the transmembrane region and most of the other regions of the protein in sufficient detail, and also enough to see many of the sugars that are attached to the amino-terminal domain of the receptor. But perhaps the most intriguing finding from these studies this year has been the discovery of what we now call the desensitization ring. And to explain this, I'd like to go through the architecture of the glutamate receptor, which you see on the left-hand side. There's the amino-terminal domain on the top. There's the ligand-binding domain, that's the second, and at the bottom is the transmembrane domain that has fourfold symmetry. Now, if you look at the same receptor from a projection view from the top, the amino-terminal domain has twofold symmetry. You can see this on the right-hand side. But our work in 2014 showed the ligand-binding domain now has apparently fourfold symmetry. At first glance, it looks like the higher-resolution work indeed confirmed this fourfold symmetry. But on closer inspection, it turns out to be a pseudo-fourfold in a very, very interesting way. And the next slide explains why this is the case. And when you look at this, if you look at the fourfold symmetry, it's not quite a fourfold symmetry because there's a slight difference in height between two of the chains and the other two chains. And this slight staggering of these helices has a profound consequence for the way these chains interact with each other to form this desensitization ring that you see on the right-hand side. Because of the stagger, there is essentially it enables this ligand-binding domain on the one hand to match the twofold symmetry of the amino-terminal domain, which is above it, and on the other hand, to match the fourfold symmetry of the channel that's below it. And as a consequence, it essentially sits in an energy well that lets it stay in the desensitized state, but also prevents it from going back to the resting state. So if you look at the three states that we now have captured, the good structures, so all of them, our contribution now is the desensitized state at atomic resolution. What you see with these Pac-Man-shaped entities in the ligand-binding domain is that it's open in the resting state. It binds the ligand. And when this closes, when the ligand is bound, it essentially opens the channel in the activated state. And when it desensitizes, it remains closed. What we now show from the structure is that the form that is able to bind the ligand, the agonist, is incompatible with the desensitized state, implying that essentially it has to unravel before it goes back to binding it. So essentially, we now have a fairly good understanding of the mechanics of how this works. This work has just been accepted at Nature. It will come out hopefully in a month or two. But it essentially underscores the value of looking at these receptors, in part because we've done this with essentially native, fully glycosylated receptors, which has been hard to do with crystallography. The second example I want to share with you is of an ion channel. It was published earlier this year in Cell. Here, again, we are trying to understand the gating mechanism of a molecule that transports magnesium ions across the membrane, it essentially as a channel. And here, there were a number of crystal structures of this molecule. And one of the conundrums from the crystal structure was the fact that the crystal structures in both the magnesium-free and the magnesium-bound states were very similar to each other. And you see a superposition of many of these structures here. These are all X-ray structures. And this was at variance with the electrophysiology, where people were convinced that there were very large conformational changes. This came from physiological studies and also biochemical and EPR studies, which all indicated that there would be large movements. But the crystal structures did not really capture it. We first, in work that we did with Eduardo Perozzo at Chicago, we first essentially got the system under control. We showed that we could do structures of the magnesium-bound state at a sufficiently high resolution. The structure shown here is the cryo-EM structure. It's reasonably good. We can figure out many of the side chains, and also good enough for us to visualize the bound magnesium ion. The structure overall very, very similar to what we've seen with X-ray crystallography. But when we did the structure of the magnesium-free state, there was a dramatic difference. And what we showed is that in the absence of the constraints of the crystal structure, there's this extraordinary break in symmetry where the whole structure essentially falls apart to be asymmetric. And then physiological studies showed that, of course, it comes back to being completely symmetric. So this idea that ion channels like this undergo such dramatic changes in symmetry when they don't have the constraints of a crystal structure does actually change the paradigm, perhaps for this family and perhaps for many other families where our thinking about how these channels work is really guided by crystallographic structures. So it's certainly worthwhile to be able to explore this in the context of membrane-like structures, which are nevertheless not constrained by the crystal lattice. The third example I want to share with you is of a protein complex, a cancer target of great interest to the National Cancer Institute and many other companies, a molecule called P97, which actually years ago Axel Brunger and Bill Weiss had done structural work on by crystallography. And it's a particularly challenging protein, both for crystallography and for EM, because it has multiple domains which are flexible, and goes to Tom's earlier point about what do you do with molecules that show various conformations where there is perhaps a spectrum or a continuum of conformations. And with P97, the crystallographic studies captured the ADP bound state, but it was very difficult to actually get to grips with the state in which the conformation of the molecule when it was bound to ATP. So in this work that was published earlier this year, we sort of took this on. And to give you a feeling for how this protein works, you can see sort of somewhat artistic impression here of the three domains of the molecule, which is where we started, which is we knew that these three pieces, the green bit, the blue bit, and the magenta bit, they're always subject to lots of changes. But our interest was very much focused on localizing molecules that actually bind P97 and inhibit it. We were able to do this successfully, and what you see here is a cryo-EM structure of P97 bound to this inhibitor, and you can see the density for, on the left-hand side at the bottom, the density for the protein itself, and also density for the bound inhibitor. And to my knowledge, this is the first report of high-resolution structure where you can actually visualize the direct structure of the inhibitor bound to a protein using cryo-EM. This work has actually led to a number of other studies. We are now actively pursuing this and many other inhibitors, possibly with a view to move them into the clinic And already, I think this could well be a very good example where these studies tell us, you know, what changes to make in the molecule to make it a better inhibitor. One of the spin-offs of this work was not just the localization of the inhibitor, but going back to what Tom mentioned earlier, was to unravel the nature of the conformational changes in the course of a catalytic cycle that P97 undergoes each time a molecule of ATP binds it. This is sort of explained in this animation, which shows the structure of P97 and shows the range of motion between three conformations, which we teased out from a mixture when ATP is added. So to look at this, you see now the three domains, N domain and D1 and D2, which are the nucleotide binding domains. When the first nucleotide binds the D2 domain, you see a subtle conformational change in the magenta layer. And then the second one binds is a much more dramatic change, which leads to very large reorganizations. These three states are present simultaneously, and you can see this now in the context of a single protomer, the same change now, where you see a smaller change when the first nucleotide binds, a larger change when the second one binds. And our task was to essentially tease this out from a mixture where all three were present. And what we were able to show is that these structures, not only were they different, but were different in a very meaningful way. The one conformation that came out clearly was one in which both the nucleotide binding domains had ADP, which you can see clearly with the densities. When the first one is exchanged, you can see one of them, the D2 domain, has an ADP exchange for ATP, and there's no doubt it's ATP gamma S because it's got the extra phosphate and the magnesium ion that is bound to. And when the second one is exchanged, you see both of them now have ATP with the magnesium bound to it. So our best understanding now of how this cycle works is by stringing these states together, and as was discussed before, of course, we have snapshots of these three states. So our understanding now is that when the first molecule of ATP binds, it leads to a conformational change in the D2 domain, which is subtle, and then when the second molecule binds, it leads to a much larger conformational change. And one of the reasons that prevented crystallographic studies of the ATP-bound state was the fact that there were these multiple conformations present, and even within the resting state, there are multiple states which we teased out in the course of doing the structure. But when the inhibitor binds, and in this case is not one that targets the active site, but is an interfacial inhibitor between the two nucleotide binding domains, it essentially acts as a monkey, puts a wrench in the works, preventing the molecule from essentially carrying these changes. So this work, actually a spin-off from this work, has been the identification of this site as a hotspot for where we might target the next generation of molecules that inhibit P97 function. The last example I want to share with you is actually three examples together, work that was published just last month, where we've begun to apply these methods to look at metabolic enzymes, particularly those involved in cancer, with a view to developing and sharpening the drug molecules that actually bind these targets both individually and in the form of complexes. To define the sort of landscape of why these are interesting, I'd like to show you something similar to what Richard showed before, which is a size spectrum of things that we've been looking at by EM. And if you look on the left-hand side, is where the field began with large icosahedral viruses. These are about many megadaltons large. Here's dengue virus, about 11 megadaltons. And over the years, especially the last 3 years or so, this has moved to progressively smaller entities. There's a work on the ribosome that Richard spoke about. This work on P97 beta galactosidase we presented. The question that we were interested in last year was, well, could we extend this to small metabolic enzymes, particularly classes of proteins such as dehydrogenases, shown on the lower side, glutamate dehydrogenase, lactate dehydrogenase, isocitrate dehydrogenase, all three, interestingly, cancer targets, but progressively smaller, from 300 down to about a little less than 100 kilodaltons. What we are now able to do because of these advances in specimen preparation, detectors, microscopes, processing, et cetera, is to be able to localize small molecules in the 145 kilodalton lactate dehydrogenase. Until a year ago, a few months ago even, the presumption was that 150 kilodaltons might be a hard stop for these kinds of resolutions, but clearly we can go beyond that now. With cryo-EM, here's the structure with a molecule that's bound to lactate dehydrogenase. The binding site is similar to those seen with molecules like this, related molecules by crystallography, so clearly it tells us that we're on the right track. We've also had some success with isocitrate dehydrogenase. IDH1 is mutated. There's key mutations in many solid tumors. And although it's small, the resolution is not particularly high. It's about 3.8 angstroms. We can begin to see in the core regions of the protein density for many of the side chains. So you can see the beta strands separated out well. But clearly, this is a challenging area. We have to work a lot harder to get the structures of these smaller proteins. And many of these proteins will be dynamic. Undoubtedly, there's lots of motion. But in this case, so we achieved what we were really after in the beginning, which is to localize a molecule called ML309, which was under development at the NCATS, National Center for Advanced Translational Sciences at the NIH. They had just, so a couple of years ago, they had this molecule as a potent inhibitor of IDH1. It really was sitting in limbo in terms of whether it had value for phase one, et cetera. And many other derivatives are being developed, but the crystallographic studies of all of these molecules has been very difficult. Not all of them crystallize. In fact, this one has been, they've been trying to crystallize this for a couple of years. But the fact that we can localize it, even at arguably low resolution, is helpful. But more interestingly, we showed that when this molecule binds, it actually leads to a rearrangement in structure. There's a quaternary structural change when this molecule binds. And that, again, is interesting to us and also gives us a way to understand how these different molecules in this family, of which we now have 30 or so that we're looking at, might actually influence the structure and function of this protein. The last example I want to share with you in this family is that of glutamate dehydrogenase, which we knew already was a very dynamic enzyme. There's many X-ray structures. It has many cofactors that bind to it, NADH, GTP, glutamate. And there's an open and a closed state that have been described by crystallography. And we were really after the potential of testing the potential of getting to these structures by cryo-EM. And although there are moving bits and pieces, and you can see in the EM density map that you can actually capture, you can visualize, looking at the density map, the center bit is relatively ordered, the outside is a bit more mobile. Nevertheless, the ordered core can be resolved very nicely. Here's a 1.8 angstrom resolution structure of GDH by cryo-EM. You can see, what you see is actually a subunit interface. The left and the right essentially are two separate polypeptide chains. And the regions where they come together, the protein is very well ordered. And the density is very well resolved. I can give you a feeling for what the map looks like. As you walk into it, there's many, many water molecules that we can pick off clearly. You can see densities from the side chains. You can see carbonyl backbone is well defined. At the same time, all of the context in the middle bit of the protein is also very well defined. Some of the residues show, especially the aliphatic residues, show densities that you expect to see at these kinds of structures. And you can see, for example, in residues like arginine and lysine, you can begin to see the kink in the backbone. You can see this clearly as we come along here. So that's encouraging to us that at least in the portions that are well ordered, one can begin to see densities that are high resolution, what you would expect from high resolution structures. So anyway, that's, as Richard said, and I'd like to echo this, I think there's many applications of these kinds of methods, and clearly the field will grow in a big way. But I want to end with a bird's eye view of how the field has grown in just the last 4 years. So here's a plot that shows the cryo-EM structures we had at resolutions better than 4.5 angstroms in the year range from 2012 to 2016 for things that are smaller than 2.5 megadaltons. So that includes all the ribosomes, it excludes the large icosahedral viruses. So if you look in the year 2012, there's just one structure that's at 4.5 angstrom resolution. When you go to 2013, the frontier moves a little bit to the left. There's just a handful, perhaps five or so, that's fit in this range. And then in 2014, there's yet another jump, many, many larger, larger assemblies, ribosomes, beginning to contribute to this. And then when you look at 2015, you can see there's this massive shift towards looking at smaller complexes, less than 0.5 megadaltons. And then when you get to 2016, there's even more. And the left end of the spectrum, of particular interest in terms of certainly my own and those of many others in terms of developing better drugs for pharmaceutical companies very much interested in this. And I think it gives you a good feeling that how of how incredible the growth in the field has been, given that 2016 is only about 50% done. And already in the examples we have, you can actually already pick off several examples where there's clearly relevance to drug discovery. I've shown you two of them, P97 and LDH, the strip V1 work from Yifan Chen's group at UCSF and work from the UK to Cambridge on the proteasome. And I think there will be many more to come. Anyway, that's what I had to say, and I'd like to thank you very much for your attention.